Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Aishwarya Kaneri, and today we are going to tell you a story about InfluxDB data sampling to avoid burning the midnight oil, and how we did this at Go-Jek. And this is?
Hi, I'm Anugrah. I work as a product engineer at Go-Jek. I work primarily with the GoFood backend, which is it delivers the food for the end user. Previously, I worked on multiple things like a lot of DevOps related stuff when I was in a data engineering team of Go-Jek. And before that, I was a product engineer for the ride-hailing backend. So, just a question: how many of you people actually know about Go-Jek? A lot. I don't think we need to explain much. But yeah. But Go-Jek is actually a services aggregator company based out of Indonesia. We have things like ride hailing, food delivery, mm-hmm. stuff like Go Massage, Go Clean, and payments on top of that. That's pretty much it, I think. Moving ahead.
I work in SRE team in Go-Jek, mainly working on Terraform automation for infrastructure, and we use console as well. Which the earlier speaker have mentioned for service mesh setup. And I work on primarily on deploying applications to Kubernetes using Helm charts. Yeah.
We had presented this previously at Influx Data webinar. This is the link for the same. Do I need to take this? Sorry. So again, a question over here. How many of you people have faced pager duty issues? Like you are in the middle of something and you get a pager duty and you had to go to the war room and face the issue and debug the issue, like a lot of memory issues, high disk space, something like that. Like, okay. So this is about that. We used to get a lot of alerts, pager duty alerts on high memory spaces on InfluxDB. And we used to spend a lot of time on debugging those issues. This is a story about that, and this is a story how we tried solving the problems by first applying the naive solutions to it, and then actually going for the major solution, and how we solved the problem, and how we automated the problem so that the problem wouldn't occur again in the future, if possible. So for this, it is essential to understand the InfluxDB architecture that the Go-Jek uses. So Aishwarya will be explaining about that.
So this is our monitoring and alerting architecture. We have Telegraph running in every VM instances, and every application, every VM is sending application, business, as well as system metrics to InfluxDB. Then we use the tick stack over here. So the capacitor queries InfluxDB to check for any alerts, and the developers will set thresholds for the alerts. Grafana queries InfluxDB so that it could get data and create dashboards for visualization. And we have our in-house beacon service, which sends Slack as well as PagerDuty alerts to the respective teams. So the architecture is as follows. The load balancer gets read and write queries for Influx, and it directly forwards the read queries to InfluxDB, while the write queries are only forwarded to the InfluxDB relay, and it makes sure that the write is done on both the InfluxDB, and we have two Influx for the reliability sake, and both are always in sync.
So let me explain about the kind of metrics that we collect and how much of those metrics do we collect. So these are a couple of things that we need to note. We collect a lot of application metrics, and by application metrics, I mean kind of metrics like how much of 4xs are being thrown out by the application, how many of them are 5xx, payment rejected or payment issues, something like that. And a lot of metrics around each API would be having its own specific codes that it would be sending out, error codes, and those kind of metrics we track under application metrics. For system metrics, we basically collect the metrics around what is the disk memory usage, what is the disk space being used, how much of disk IO is being done, how much of memory usage is being done, how much of DB connections are made, a lot of things like that. And for business metrics, we push out a feature, we have a bunch of business metrics we collect. Like an example that comes to my mind is that last time at GoResto, we had pushed out a feature for managing the catalog, specifically for the editing of the price by the restaurateurs. So when we were doing this, we wanted to get an initial idea of how many people were actually using it on a real-time basis. So what we did is that we collected out the metrics and we were sending it to InfluxDB on how many people were using it to edit the price and how many times they were editing price per item. We want to see on real-time how many people were facing issues with that thing so that any improvements need to be done on that. So essentially, the feedback loop for a feature is necessary for our business. And for collecting those business metrics, we use InfluxDB on a real-time basis. And after that, whenever we want to make a business decision and going forward, we use the aggregate metrics. But when we start off with that thing, we collect it over Influx. So so these are the kind of metrics that get sent over to our InfluxDB. And this is one of those interesting statistics, wherein what happens is that one of the teams, when we were doing an audit, we found out that one of the teams were actually sending over 55,153 data points per second. And there were a lot of teams like this, I mean, close to this, like 40, couple of them. And we have around 25 teams. Since we actually follow the methodology of having product teams, there are around 25 teams which are handling each and every, like, couple of products. So with this, this is the data around how much statistics and how what sort of metrics that we collect. Going forward. Now, as we all know, Murphy's Law states that whatever can go wrong will definitely go wrong. And with this, and at the scale at which we operate, what we get is essentially this. We get a lot of these kind of alerts, wherein the high memory usage on DB triggers, and people need to wake up in the middle of the night and actually start debugging the issue and reducing the memory or reducing the size, deleting the logs, and resizing the disk. This kind of firefighting became an issue. And there were a couple of things that we did to solve this problem. Oh yeah, we'll go with the problems encountered, my bad. So the kind of problems that we encountered is basically is that we were facing a lot of high memory usage because we were sending a lot of time series data into Influx, and Influx actually does store it in the in-memory for making the reads slightly faster. So the memory usage actually starts spiking. And after that, whenever it is done with that for a period of time, it writes it to the disk. And in essential, the disk usage also spikes up after some time. And there were increasing number of series and measurements. After once we rolled out the tick stack for the metrics collection, people started using it more and more, and more teams were getting onboarded. And other teams also wanted to record their own business metrics and other stuff. So there were an increasing number of series and an increasing number of measurements that is being collected at the Influx. So we were getting a lot of page duty alerts. And yes, we were not getting enough sleep. Now I give it to Aishwarya to explain the usage, high memory usage.
The high memory usage in InfluxDB, many people using Influx must have noticed this constantly. So this occurs because we were using 1.4 version of Influx, wherein the TSM model is implemented. So what it does is, the data which is stored inside the disk, it will get all the indexes into its in-memory, and just for fast lookups. And that's why the memory starts getting consumed a lot. So we found some quick temporary fixes for this, like we increased the limit on the number of series and measurements which were pushed by the corresponding product teams. Then we made the entire InfluxDB infrastructure setup for like team-wise. So every team had two InfluxDB which were kept in sync and two relays along with one load balancer. So this was the horizontal scaling being done. And we also tried vertical scaling by increasing the disk size and memory size. But none of it actually gave us the results which we wanted. They were just temporary fixes.
Now we had to think about a solution which actually could fix our problems instead of having vertical scaling and people on call every time and keep on doing these kind of scaling issues, keep on dealing with the scaling issues. So what we did is essentially is data downsampling. Now, what exactly is data downsampling? So you can see what happens over here. Let's say take an example between 17.0 to 17.10. There are like 10 data points that have been collected over for that period of time. like a bunch of metrics, like how many requests are coming or something similar to that. So what you could see is that if there are no anomalies to this time series data, you can simply represent that by a data point, which would be the mean of all data points aggregated from 1700 to 1710. This would perfectly well when you are dealing with in a long time when you are looking at the data, this data point can represent the data series. But if you are facing any production issues wherein there would be an anomalous spikes to, so let's say, the number of connections being open or something similar to that, this doesn't work. So the kind of solution that we developed will be explained by Aishwarya, and how that solved these issues will also be explained over.
So for implementing data downsampling, there are two steps. The first one is the continuous query. So this is a periodic query which will run after every time interval t, which is configurable. And what this does is it queries the normal data measurement. In our case, we were sending one data point per 10 seconds. And it will aggregate it by 5 minutes in our case. And it will dump this downsample data into the same measurement, but a different retention policy. So the second step was of retention policy. So this is this policy states for how long you want to retain the data inside the database. So we created two retention policies. One was autogen, which was the default one, for the normal data, which is coming at a rate of one data point per 10 seconds. And the downsampled retention policy was for 4 weeks. And the downsampling rate was 5 minutes. So earlier, we wanted to reduce the retention period for the normal data itself. Earlier, it was 4 weeks. But as the product teams didn't want to do that because they wanted to analyze the data at least for at least 1 month. So we did the data downsampling, and now if the product teams want to analyze data, they refer the downsampled data, and if some prod issue is coming, they refer to the normal data. So the unknowns which we faced in data downsampling, while doing data downsampling, were when we added the continuous query, it actually increased the load on InfluxDB because it is a periodic query. So the documentation says that the continuous query interval should be the same as your aggregation interval. So in our case, it was 5 minutes. So once we set it to 5 minutes, this issue was solved. Then in our case, we had database names with hyphen in it, and which were not supported by the InfluxDB client. So we had to make a commit in that to support hyphen. And the third one, which was a major issue, is whatever data is downsampled, it's written into the same measurement but a different retention policy. And one major difference happens is every column name gets prepended with mean, because we are using mean as the aggregator. So we couldn't ask all 25 product teams to create a new dashboard just for viewing the downsampled data, because that's not practically possible. So we came up with a regex solution for this. So let's see how the visualization is done on Grafana for both normal as well as downsampled data. This is the normal data, which is coming at a rate of one data point per 10 seconds. As you can see here, we have used the regex, and on top, we have created a template. So you can select whichever policy data you want to see. So autogen is the default one for viewing the normal data during prod issues. And the second one is using the same regex and the same dashboard, but changing the template over here. So we select last 4 days to view the downsampled data. So whatever retention policy selected in this template is comes over here in the query. So the same dashboard can be used by the product teams to view both normal as well as downsampled data.
Sorry. So, as I explained, there are a lot of reasons for having data downsampling automations. Simply, we could not go to 25 teams and ask them to do the same operation again and again. The human errors would keep on increasing. So we had to go for a downsampling automation solution. And we used Chef for this. Before going that, there is a, just for the, so this is about somebody once told to me that solutions at scale where you are trying to build for any kind of problems at scale, you need automation to solve the problem. Otherwise, the same solution itself turns it into a problem. Going forward, this is about the automation scripts that was used for the data downsampling. I'll give it back again.
So we used Chef Cookbook for automating this, and so this we did for all the InfluxDB infrastructure for every team, and this was pretty straightforward and took very less time because it was automated. The first one is the continuous query recipe. So we pass the continuous query name, and this continuous query will be doing the data downsampling. We do this for every database inside InfluxDB, and the interval which we gave, the CQ interval, that is the continuous query interval, was 5 minutes. And what this query does is it takes the mean for every 5 minute interval, and it aggregates the data and puts it in the same measurement but under different retention policy. The second one was the downsampling recipe. Where we are doing this for every database, we are giving CQ name, CQ interval, and the retention policies. One is autogen and the other one is last 4 weeks for downsampled data. And here you can see the continuous query script which will be run at midnight. So we faced an issue that when we did data downsampling in the two InfluxDBs which we had, and they were already in sync. But when we do the data downsampling at different times, we were seeing a lag in the Grafana dashboards. So we wanted to start the downsampling in both the boxes at the same time. So that's why this cron is scheduled to run data downsampling queries at the same time. And this is the resource for data downsampling, where the retention policies are created by giving the policy name and on which database you want to apply this retention policy and the replication factor over here.
So there were a couple of things that we kind of gained as learning towards this. We saw a significant reduction in the memory usage and disk usage after going forward with the continuous query-based approach. Automation helped us to scale the solution for multiple InfluxDB clusters, since we did not need to kind of go and write at each and every InfluxDB replicas that we had built for each and every team. So yeah, that's pretty much it. And we did not face any kind of pager duties after that. And no more sleepless nights. That's it. Yeah, we are coming soon to Singapore, like a lot of people would know. Any questions?
Is it allowed to ask questions without mission code?
Is it allowed to?
Without mission code?
Yeah, I think, I don't know. I mean, we can just come.
I think you need to raise hands if you have a question.
Ah, perfect.
Why don't we trust that we use the memory?
I mean, go
ahead. So we tried the vertical scaling as well by increasing the memory, but as the number of series, which the data which was pumped from the product team, it was increasing constantly. And the TSM model, all the indexes are from the disk, they are taken into memory just for fast lookups. So as the series and measurement increases, it's directly proportional to the memory size being consumed. So we cannot just go on increasing the memory size infinitely.
It reaches a limit, basically. Beyond that, it starts throwing out ohm errors, like out of memory ranges errors, and then it then crashes.
Yeah, so you can just more memory.
More memory, and
you can have terabyte of memory.
Yeah, and keep on doing it forever. It's not scalable.
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
Anybody else?
Have you guys tried
using Influx Cloud as a solution, rather than scaling it like that?
We didn't use Influx Cloud.
Influx had like a managed service for this Influx Cloud, and we do interface the same thing.
Okay.
So,
Does it solve the, when you have a lot of series, does it solve the problem for that also?
I mean, we are like in the POC stage, so I don't know whether you guys have this, so I just want to get some
advice. No, we did not. That's why we wanted to know from you.
So when you downsample your data, usually you solve the problem. You solve the problem with the intersection. At the same time, you lost the peaks, the lows. So how did you, was that acceptable to your business? Basically, essentially, when you're downsampling, you're losing some of the data.
Yeah.
Right, and sometimes the mean values do not really tell you the truth.
True.
There are a lot of peaks,
and
those are normal
values.
You obviously compromise with that data. So,
I mean,
is it always acceptable to the business in
all scenarios? So, the kind of downsampling that we did, the question becomes what sort of data is important for the business, and what sort of data do we gain any kind of insight or advantage from? Does it require, when doing some approach, does it give me out a value or not? So if you're looking at, let's say, production issues or something similar to that, that's the time these sort of system metrics become valuable. Like, we know that the peak is increasing because of these reasons. Or we see our DB connection is suddenly spiking up because we are getting a lot of throughput. And some people have not done, let's say, the DB pooling or any of those approaches, and it spikes out. So these sort of things become valuable only during the production issues. So for getting that value out of those sort of values, what we have done is that we have done a normal autogen-based thing. So that can be a real-time dashboard, and they open it and see it over there. Like recently, we had a prod issue where we had to do that, and we did it according to that. So any kind of previous data where we need to observe that these sort of spikes happened, or let's say 4 weeks back or 3 weeks back, or a specific cloud-based VM is having some sort of an issue or something similar to that, then the downsampled data can show it. It will be having a spike around that. Because anyways, a singular spike will be showing up on a periodic basis. The retention policy around this helps us solving that problems. So coming to the business metrics, like if you're asking for a particularly about the business metrics or something similar to that, the business metrics initially was around to know whether how many people are using it in real time and how many people are facing issues. So specifically around phasing issues. If they are facing issues, we need to get on what sort of issue are they facing, why are they not able to use the feature like we thought they would be using it. So those kind of metrics, real-time data is solved through the autogen, but the other kind of data, then the business metrics over a period of aggregate, what happens is that they use another, like how many people are using these things, that they have Kafka-based storage for that. They have their own architecture for that where they can query and find out that these many people have used it in a day and other stuff. So essentially, the value that we should be getting out of this thing has not been lost, and in turn, we have gotten some advantage over the infrastructure and things. You want to add something?
Yeah, that's
fine. Does it add your? Does it answer your question? Sure.
Anybody else?
I've not heard a lot about InfluxDB, but did you guys try query optimization to see if that helps? Because you said you've tried scaling up, which did not work. But I'm not sure, downsampling the data, how much data is lost in that or not. But did you guys try query optimization, or which queries were actually causing those alerts? And try to solve the bottom most problem over there.
Okay. So it was not the queries which were raising the alerts, but the data, the amount of data which was present in DB, that because of that we were getting the alerts of like high disk and high memory usage. As the series were increasing, because the only Grafana and capacitor queries the InfluxDB. Capacitor is for for sending alerts to check whether the data has crossed the threshold, and Grafana was for visualization. So our main problem was that the series which are entering the InfluxDB, they were increasing.
Okay. Yeah.
Nice.
Any party?
Thanks, it's mainly for Elastic Search.
Elasticsearch for time series data.
Elasticsearch, we have not explored for the time series data. We have explored it for text search based things. Because it is actually optimized, if I understand correctly, I might be wrong over here. Is there some reason why you would use Elasticsearch over time series DBs? Like, I'm just asking, that's all.
Well, I'm just curious for time series data.
So these things, what happens in time series DB, if I understand correctly, they kind of make it optimized. So they have built their own approach called TSMs, which is built on top of LSMs, log storage management structures. So they, in a log storage, what happens is that they merge it together and compact it. So when you are doing a normal event-based and metrics-based things, what InfluxDB does is that InfluxDB optimized it for time series. So it becomes optimized for this thing. I haven't explored that. Frankly, I haven't explored it.
Any other alternatives to InfluxDB?
Yeah, Prometheus is one. So right now we are moving our applications from VM to containers in Kubernetes. So we are exploring, running Prometheus operator daemon sets in Kubernetes.
Yeah. How many measurements or series you are talking about?
Can you repeat?
How many series you have in your DB?
We'll have to check the exact number, but when we audited, we got 55,000
data
points.
Yeah. We'll have to see. We'll come back to you. We forgot it actually.
But the limit which we have put right now on the one of the quick fix was to put the limit on series which are coming into DB. So right now we have put 20K as the limit. So we were getting definitely more than 20K series.
You're using SSDs or normal disk?
SSD.
Yeah. Any questions? That's it. Right, thank you very much.
Thank you.